Over the last couple weeks, we've been talking about faith, and the reason that we've been doing that is because we're in a season in our church of prayer and fasting. And the reason that we're doing that is because we want to put God first in our year, but also first in our lives. And so every day from January the 10th until the end of January, we are meeting Monday through Friday at 6 a.m. here in the sanctuary and Saturdays at 8 a.m. And what we're doing is praying. And we prayed for you this week if you're here. We've been praying for you. We hope that you've had a great week, and we are glad that you ended up here. But I want you to know that we've been praying for you, and you can be a part of that if you want to come this week, 6 a.m. Monday through Friday, and 8 a.m. on Saturdays. But we're going to get going this morning. If you have your Bibles, turn to Genesis 11 with me. Genesis 11 and verse 31. And then we're going to read right through 32 and into chapter 12. If you don't have a Bible with you this morning, there's a gold Bible right in front of you. And you can turn in that Bible to page 11, and that'll get you where we're going. If you don't own a Bible, you can take that home with you today. That'll be our gift to you. So Genesis 11, starting in verse 31. We're talking about Abraham today, but when we pick up in the story, he is still just Abram, and he's the father of our faith, and this is the beginning of his story with God. And so it says in verse 31, Terah took Abram his son and Lot the son of Haran, his grandson, and Sarai his daughter-in-law, his son Abram's wife, and they went forth together from Ur of the Chaldeans to go into the land of Canaan. But when they came to Haran, they settled there. The days of Terah were 205 years, and Terah died in Haran. Now the Lord said to Abram, go from your country and your kindred, your father's house, to the land that I will show you. And I will make of you a great nation, and I will bless you and make your name great so that you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and him who dishonors you I will curse. And in you all of the families of the earth shall be blessed. And so Abram went as the Lord had told him, and Lot went with him. Abram was 75 years old when he had departed from Haran. And Abram took Sarai, his wife, and Lot, his brother's son, and all their possessions that they had gathered, and the people that they had acquired in Haran. And they set out to go to the land of Canaan. Pray with me if you would this morning. Lord, we come to you and humbled by the fact that we can even come into your presence. Lord, we are so glad to be here. And Lord, while we're here, we want you to speak to us, Father. We want to encounter you in a real way. Father, I thank you that your word is living and active and that it can still speak to us today. And Father, I pray that your Holy Spirit would give us the wisdom that we need to understand it. Father, bless my mouth and hide me behind your cross, Father. Help us to encounter you and grow our faith today. It's through Jesus we pray, and amen. All right, so I want to start off and talk about Terah. Terah was the father of Abram, and they were living in a place called Ur of the Chaldeans. And Terah, we're not really sure why he left the place that he was at. We're not really sure, but I believe that Terah had a reason that he left Ur of the Chaldeans. I believe that he left there for a reason, but I also believe that he was going to a certain place. And he may not have known where he was going, but he knew when he was going to get there. He knew he had to leave, but he may not have necessarily known where he was going. And so Terah left a place called Ur. And I wanted to tell you that Ur in Hebrew, it means a valley. Valleys in ancient times, they were places of refuge. They were places where you could grow crops. It was a place of prosperity. And Terah, he packs up everything that he owned. He picked up everything, all of his people, all of his family. And he leaves the place that he was familiar with. And Terah is going to a certain place, but he stops at a place called Haran. He stops at a place called Haran. And Haran means a mountainous place or a mountainous country. But what I found interesting is it said that Terah settled there. He settled there. And I just wonder if he had left that valley of Ur and he had started on his journey and he encountered the opposition of that mountain. And he decided that what was on the other side of that mountain was not worth going over that mountain. I wonder if he decided it would just be easier to settle at the base of this mountain than to go over into the thing that I started out to get. And as I thought about that this week, I thought, how many times has God given me a direction to go? A place to go, a destination that He's called me to. And I left a place of ease, but when I got to a place of opposition, I just settled. I just quit because the going got rough. I wonder how many times that God has given us a destination, that God has given us a place that He wants us to be, a dream for our life, and we settle for less than God, what God wants for our lives. He settled in a place called Haran. And I wonder how many of us have settled for less than God's best in our life because we experienced opposition, because we experienced people coming against us or things coming against us or bad circumstances. I wonder how many times we settle in a place called Haran when there's still a Canaan to be had. So many times we stop short and we settle. We settle. I never want us to be a church that settles. Because here's what happens when you settle. It says that Terah died in the place where he settled. Terah died in the place where he settled. And I believe that if you settle for less than God's best for your life, you may just die there. You may just die on that side of the mountain, never realizing all that God had for your life. So if I could say one thing to start us off, don't settle at Haran. Don't settle for Haran. Because you might just die where you settle. But then something begins to happen at the beginning of verse 12. Abram begins hearing from the Lord. He begins hearing from the Lord and he becomes discontented with the place where his father had settled. And here's what I believe. I believe that when the Lord begins to speak to you and when you begin to listen to Him, you'll be discontented with the place where you are. You'll be discontented to stay in that season of your life. You don't want to stay in Haran when the Lord begins to speak to you. You'll want to move forward into all that He has for you. And so, many of you have settled in Haran, but you begin to get nervous when somebody starts talking about moving into Canaan. Let me speak to some of the older people here today. You may have settled in a place. You may have settled in a place called Haran, and you may be perfectly comfortable in a place called Haran. And life may be good. We don't know what Terah's life was like, but for you, life may be good in Haran. But there may be a generation that comes up behind you that begins hearing from the Lord, and they may be discontented with Haran, and they may desire Canaan. They may be willing to go over the mountain. Don't stop them. Don't stop them when they begin speaking, when the Lord begins speaking to them, and they begin hearing. They will be uncomfortable in the place where you're comfortable. They'll want to move forward into all that God has for them, and so don't stop them. Let them go over the mountain. Let them move forward. And let them move towards Canaan. So we see Abram, he's leaving Haran. He's packed up some of his family and he's packed up some of his possessions and he says, I can't stay here any longer. I can't stay here any longer. I've settled long enough. I've settled long enough. And so Abram, he decides to leave Haran. And he starts heading towards Canaan. But Hebrews 11 gives us a little bit more insight into what Abram was doing. And Hebrews 11, 8 through 12, it says, by faith, Abraham obeyed when he was called to go out to a place that he was to receive an inheritance. And he went out not knowing where he was going. By faith, he went to live in the land of promise as in a foreign land, living in tents with Isaac and Jacob, heirs with him of the same promise. For he was looking forward to the city that has foundations, whose designer and builder is God. And by faith, Sarah herself received power to conceive, even when she was past the age, since she considered him faithful who had promised. And therefore one man, and him as good as dead, were born descendants as many of the stars of heaven, and as many as the innumerable grains of the sand by the seashore. Did you catch that? When Abram left Haran, he didn't know where he was going. He didn't know where he was going. God told Abram, pack all of your stuff up and start walking. And I'll let you know when you get there. I'll guide you. I'll give you the directions. He didn't write out a roadmap for Abram on a piece of rock. Abram, he said, go where I tell you to go, and you'll end up where I have for you. But that's so frustrating to me. It's so frustrating when God tells you to do something, but He's not specific. When God tells you it's time to move, but He don't tell you where you're going. When He tells you that something's about to change, but He doesn't tell you what you're supposed to do. I want God to give me a step-by-step, play-by-play plan for my life. That's what I really want from God. I want God to lay out for me the next 35 years of my life so that I know what's coming. That's what I really want from God. But that's not how God works. That's not how God works. If He told you everything that was coming, if He told you everything that was going to go on, it wouldn't require any faith to walk in that direction. If you knew exactly where you were going, it would not require faith. And so 2 Corinthians 5:7 says, for we walk by faith and not by sight. We walk by faith and not by sight. If you remember from last week, that faith is the firm conviction for something for which there is no evidence. That means you believe something in spite of what you see, in spite of what you smell, and in spite of all of your senses, you believe something against the odds. And so when we're walking by faith, we might not have any evidence for the direction that we're going. People may say, why are you going that direction? That leads nowhere. Why would you give up that? Why would you do that? Why would you go that way? And we may not have anything to say other than that's the direction I believe I ought to go. Let me tell you a story. When I was a senior in high school, I had big plans for my life. I had been accepted into the College of Engineering at UK, and I thought that's the direction that I'm gonna go. I'm gonna go and be an engineer, and maybe when I retire, I can serve the Lord, and maybe I can go be a missionary after I retire and I have a lot of money. And so I had plans of going to UK that fall. Had a roommate and everything lined up, but the Lord wouldn't let me settle there. So I went to EKU for a year and started my engineering degree there. But the Lord wouldn't let me settle there. And He began putting on my heart that I was called into the ministry full time. And so I walked away from a scholarship and from really a good career because I felt like the Lord was leading me in this direction. And for many people in my family, they said, you're crazy. You're crazy. What are you doing? Why would you do that? Why would you walk away from engineering to preach? That's crazy. And to be honest with you, I agreed with them. You know what I'm saying? I agreed that it didn't make a lot of sense, but I didn't have any evidence to push me in that direction. I just had what I believed the Lord was telling me. And so I had to step out in faith. And now, 5 years later, here we are. And I'm glad that I took that step. I'm glad I went in that direction. But sometimes we have to step out in a direction where we have no evidence. When it doesn't make sense, when it doesn't ride up just right, we have to take a step in that direction. Walking by faith means that you walk according to what you believe and not according to what you see. God never asks us to step out in a direction where we know all the answers. If you feel like God's asking you to step out in faith, but you know how everything's going to work, that may not be God. That may be your common sense trying to override your faith. God wants us to step out in a place where we have to trust Him. But if we know the direction we're going, we're never going to stop to ask Him for directions. And wives, you know this. You know this because your husband, he won't stop for directions until he is totally and utterly lost. When you have crossed another state line, then he might stop for directions. But that's the way we do in our spiritual lives. If God does not put us in a place where we don't know where to go, we won't turn to Him. And so that's the place where He wants us. That's the place where we totally depend on Him, where we totally give our lives to Him. And for every step we take and every move we make, we have to say, God, what is Your will? Where am I going? Because I have no clue. That is what God wants for our lives. Until we've totally lost our sense of direction in our lives, we never turn to Him. And so He wants us to walk by faith and not by sight. I'm glad that I can make decisions in my life based on what I believe about God and not what I see in my situation. Because sometimes my situation looks pretty grim. Sometimes my situation looks pretty desperate. Sometimes it looks like things are totally falling apart. But in the middle of the messiness of life, in the middle of the craziness of life, there's an anchor that I can hold to, knowing that God is for me no matter what things look like. And the God who created heaven and earth, the God who set all of this in motion, He's watching out for me. He's watching out for me. And He wants the best for me. And so even if life seems crazy, even if it seems like everything is falling apart, I have a rock to which I cling that is that God loves me. And He is for me. And He is watching out for me. And so, in the middle of all of life's craziness, maybe you feel like your marriage is falling apart. You can cling to Jesus' word when He said, "What I have put together, no man can separate." When the doctors have given up hope and say, you've gone too far, the disease has spread too much, you can cling to the hope that He was wounded for our transgressions and by His stripes we are healed. There is hope found in the Word of God. Your bank account may be empty and your cabinets may be empty too. But you can trust that God owns a cattle of 1,000 hills, and He owns the hills that they're standing on and the grass that they're eating. And He can provide for you. We can believe that the God who gave His own Son will not withhold any other good thing from those He loves. We can hold on to God when everything else seems to be going away. You don't have to believe what your senses are telling you. You don't have to believe what your eyes see, or your ears hear, or your nose smells, or your tongue tastes. Those senses will lie to you. Those senses, and that seems counterintuitive because we normally only believe what we can see. There's that old adage to only believe, don't believe anything you hear and half of what you see. But we can't trust our senses. We have to trust the Word of God and what He has said for our lives. And so, maybe you feel like you're going through the worst pain of your life and you feel like this pain could have no purpose. Maybe you feel like there is no way that any good could come out of this particular situation. We can trust what Romans 8 says, that He's working all things together for the good of those who love and diligently seek Him. We can remember that God is working everything out. He didn't everything was good. He said He's going to work it to make it good for us. He wants the best for you and me. And so I believe that the hardest thing that we ever have to do in our Christian walk as we walk with God is to stop trusting our feelings and our senses. We have to stop trusting what we see and what we feel, so that we can trust what God has said. You cannot trust your feelings and your senses and trust God. You have to pick one. You have to pick one. You can trust what you see, or you can trust what God says. And so I want to bring this in for a landing with a question. A simple question. Can you say yes to God before you know the question? Can you say yes to God before you know the question? Here's what I mean. It's easy for us to say yes or no to God when we know exactly what the commitment is. When we know exactly what the cost is. When God lays out everything for us, it would be easy to say, yes, I'm willing to give that up, or no, I'm not willing to give that up. It's easy to respond to the question, will you say yes to God, if you know what the question is. But for us today, will you say yes to God before you know what the commitment is? Will you say yes to God before you know what it will cost you? Will you say yes to God before He asks you the question? It's a simple matter of trust. And here's what I believe for us. I believe that we need to make a pre-decision. A pre-decision is the decision you make before it's time to make the decision. That we need to make a pre-decision to say yes to God. Before He asks for that thing, before He asks you to go to that place, before He asks you to talk to that person, we need to go ahead and say, yes, God. Whatever it is, I'm willing to give it up. This is the kind of reckless abandonment that God wants in our lives, that no matter what He asks for, we can give it. It's a decision to say, God, whatever You want. God, whatever You want, I'm willing to give that to You. You gave me everything, God. And so whatever You want, I'll hold nothing back. What are you holding back from God? What are you holding back from God? Is it your savings account? If it costs me my savings account, then God, You gave me the money anyway. And if it costs me my friends, God, You're the only friend I need. If it costs me job, God, You are my provider. I'm willing to give up anything if it costs me my reputation. God, Yours is the only approval I long for. Can we recklessly abandon ourselves to God? Can we say yes to God? Before we know the question, wherever He asks you to go, whoever He asks you to talk to, whatever He asks you to give, whatever He asks you to do, we can make that decision by faith today. Even though God could ask for whatever He wants, we can say yes because we know that He's looking out for our good. We can recklessly abandon to a God who is looking out for us. I just tell you, I had much rather have God watching out for me than watch out for myself. He sees a lot more than I do. He knows a lot more than I do. And I can trust Him with everything I have. Everything I have, I can put it in His hands because I know that He is a better manager of what I have than I am. This morning, He won't ask us to give up anything that He won't replace with something better. If He asks you to give up something, it's for a reason. And He's going to give you blessings back for that more than you could ever comprehend. So I want to challenge us today to make the faith decision that whatever happens in 2017, whatever's going on in our lives in 2017, no matter what it costs, we can say yes to God. What is it that you need to say yes to God about today? Where are you holding back from God? What part of your life do you need to surrender this morning to God? Where are you still trying to control? What is it in your life that you need to give up and that you need to say yes to God? If you're here this morning and it's the first time you've been to church in a while, or maybe you're here and you don't even consider yourself a believer, you don't really identify as a Christian. I want you, if you don't hear anything else this morning, this is what I want you to hear. God loves you. God loves you. Despite of what you've done or who you've been or where you've been, God loves you. And He's looking out for you. He wants the best for you. God wants the best for you, but He knows that the best, your best life starts with Him. Your best life starts in a relationship with Him. And He wants you to come to the place of total dependence on Him. And that's where real life begins. That's where real life begins. And the Bible says that all it takes to start a relationship with God is to believe. Faith. Putting our trust in God. Making the decision that you can't save yourself, you can't control yourself, you can't control your own life, and that you need God to do it for you. It's making the decision to follow Jesus wherever He goes. And I don't want you to think that it won't cost you something, because it will cost you something. Some people don't tell you when you're starting out that following Jesus will cost you something. But I can promise you this morning that it'll cost you something. But He'll never ask you to give up anything that you won't be glad to give up in the end. He'll always give you something back, much more than what you've given up. And so, here's what I want us to do. We're getting ready to have altar call here, but before we do that, everybody close your eyes and bow your head. If you want to make a decision today, if you're a person in this house and you've decided that you can't do this on your own, you can't live this life on your own, you can't be the person that God wants you to be on your own, and you've decided today that you want to put your faith in Jesus, if you would just lift up your hand for just a second, I'd love to pray for you. I'm not going to call you out. I'm not going to pull you up here. I just want to pray for you this morning as you make that decision. So if right now, if you want to make that decision, you can just raise your hand. Or maybe you're here and you're already a Christian, you're already a believer, but you've really walked away from God. You've really just stepped away from God, and this morning you want to give your life back to Christ. You want to make a commitment to Jesus this morning and give Him your life back. Would you just raise your hand? I want to pray for us this morning. God, we pray this morning that for every person in this house, but especially for those who have maybe never made a commitment to follow You, never made a decision to follow You, God. Lord, I pray that more than anything in this moment, that You would show them that You love them, and that You would show them that You care about them, and that You're not judging them, but You want to forgive them. God, You want their life so that You can give them abundant life. God, I pray for those who may be making decisions right now. God, just wrap them up in Your arms.